Hello, this is Nick again. We're going to the second part of this presentation, NeurIPS recap 2023 trends in AI, and we're going to talk about distributed language models, composing big models from smaller ones. The main ideas we discussed in the beginning of this review is the large language model as a giant vector. And there's plenty of papers that I compiled from references before I go into the details. I wanna brainstorm with you about the new idea of what I'm gonna call software 3.0. So in 2017, a blog post by Andrei Karpathy came talking about the software 2.0, where he says that the new paradigm of programming right now is by basically, the programmer is compiling data, maybe annotating them, and then you train a neural network, and now your new program is, it's the weights, all the knowledge, all the program is hidden into the weights of the neural network. And then you're just getting new images and it tells you, is it the cat or what is it? So you call that the software 2.0 paradigm, where the programmers are data labelers, and you compile everything. Your new binary is the neural network, like the weights of the network. But now, if we think about it, like that implied that right now, when we do, for example, a language model, it looks like that you have a huge data set, which is, I don't know, your C++ file, and you compile it once, you keep training it. But that's not how we write software. We just, whenever you build a product in your company, you just don't write thousands of lines, I don't know, hundreds of thousands of lines in one program. You need to modularize it, you need to, compile it separately, link it, put it into libraries. So looks like that idea of 2.0 was a very interesting direction, but there was something missing, and let's see if this idea of combining smaller language model takes us to the language model or software 3.0. So here's what I argue that we can do. So yes, the data curation is you as a programmer working in VS Code, let's say, where you are basically creating different sets of data. Okay, then you can probably go and compile your own small language model. So that's your GCC. You're compiling an object file. Think about it. You can use it or not. Then you need to use the fp command because you need somehow, when you build, when you put everything in a library, it creates an index so that if you need to create an executable, you need to find out how to combine them. So this is something that it has a name. It's called task to vec. So each language model that you are training on a specific smaller data set, it gets assigned a vector that tells you what is it in there. Okay, like what does it do? And it could be that the task to vec is the whole language model or is an averaging of the layers. There's several ways of doing that. And then when you want to eventually build your executable, something that translates from, I don't know, Greek to Chinese, and you realize that you have to take the language model of Greek to English, English to French, French to Chinese, you have to go search on the task vectors, find which language models a good one for this task, and then do the linking, and oops, you got your new model. And of course, if you want to do something like that, you need a tool like Git. Okay, so there's something called Git Theta. We're going to see about that. That is exactly this thing, allows people to, develop, independently, and then merge the changes. So you take my language model, you fine-tuning on something else, somebody else is fine-tuning on something else, and then we need to merge them to get the final one. So I find this very exciting. So I don't know. This is again kind of like a Nick's prediction here. Is this technology, I think it has the potential, but will it be materialized to give us the software 3.0, which is much closer to what we're used to in real production settings in software engineering. Now, again, you've seen some of the slides, and there is we don't have time to go through that, but again, you do algebra, you have different tasks, you have what they call intermediate task training, fine-tuning, you have a probing task. I don't want to go to the details, but I promise I will create another presentation about that. And, you know, as in big software projects, things are written in different languages and they're running in heterogeneous hardware. Unfortunately, right now, you know, when you take Llama 2, you have to run it on a bunch of 8100s and they have to all be the same. And that costs a lot of money. And what do you do with the GPUs that you bought last year and they're smaller? So there's this project called Petals, where they basically can run parts of the language model distributed over the web, different hardware, and you can combine them. That's I don't know, is that the blockchain of neural networks of language models? We'll see. But that's an interesting idea. That's something we definitely need. Okay, because there's a big cost. If you ever try to do things with GPUs, it's a big cost and it's kind of like a nightmare. And, you know, you can read about how you start from a base model and you fine-tune models and you merge them together, you know, what we call Git rebasing. And, you know, if you want, you can read a blog post also on that. And there's a whole taxonomy of how you're doing the merging. Again, very interesting to read. Now, in that spirit, there's other groups that they're working on the incremental maintenance of large language models. One of the biggest problems, you know, we might change president in a year. How do you go back and you edit that? Or how do you, you know, keep growing the model? Like as we call, do a lifelong pre-training. And people do like this mixture of experts where now you're getting a new expert and that expert should be getting more attention because it's newer. So also very interesting. You know, okay, you know, this is a good problem to have once you have the language models, but the next part that I'm gonna talk about is how do you build a large language model from scratch? Okay, so, we need to find ways of democratizing the LLM building. You know, we discussed about, you know, are you bound by data? There's the scaling panel. There was a workshop, tutorial called Attrib, which we're going to talk about that, or workshop, I don't remember. And then we're going to see the effort of democratization of large language models. In terms of building. And the last one, it was one of the papers that didn't win any award, but won, let's say, the audience award, the audience Grammy award here, because it did solve a problem that was very costly for doing what we call instruction tuning. And if you're not familiar about its instruction tuning, this you know, invention of instruction tuning is what basically made language models what they are today. So until GPT-3, yeah, there was some kind of impressive things, but not really ready to put in production. And then the instruction tuning, you know, by OpenAI, of course, created the ChatGPT that made the boom, you know. And but that was a very costly process because it uses what we call reinforcement learning with human in the loop. And that paper kind of like took that out of the, you know, it was an algorithmic improvement. And I'm just putting over there because it was something that reduced the costs and made language models more accessible. So all the necessary plumbing for building language models infrastructure is not easy. This is from Colossal AI. It's a Berkeley project. I think there's a company right now or an organization. I don't know their structure, but you know the disappointing, you know, scaling of GPUs. That was the trend for parameters, I don't know, in the 2016, it was like 40x every 2 months. Turns out it was like 340x. It changed the scaling. It shifted. So, you know, there's a gap over there. You know, we can't fit everything on a GPU. Now, Colossal AI with some evidence here, presented some evidence. where they believe, why they believe in large language models. And they say, you know, the teraflops per dollar is rising about twice every year. The you know, the GPU prices and memory are falling exponentially the other way around, you know, the per gigabyte. So you can see that they're becoming cheaper and cheaper. So, you know, you're going to see different numbers over there, but the budget right now is $3 million to train something, and they believe by 2026, obviously it's prohibitive for a startup to train from scratch and maintain their own language models. That was like 2020. Yeah, they believe it can go down to $73,000 by 2026 to do something like GPT-3. GPT-3 is 170 billion parameters. Okay, so we're getting there. But as of now, you know, obviously you need to retrain things. The problem we just discussed before, you know, 2019, and you know, that's expensive. Inference and fine tuning is, you don't really, it doesn't fit on a single GPU, so you have to do a lot of plumbing. You know, for Palm, they say the cost was at least $10 million. For deployment, the company needs 70 people building their internal tools for AI. It's estimated like for $20 million cost per year to do that stuff. It's probably why people are using OpenAI. Nobody can afford that. And also the ethical, you know, part of it, the carbon footprint, it burns a village to build one of them. You can see some numbers over here. You know, we also have to think about the planet in the end, okay? Before AI takes over, maybe the planet will collapse by all the energy we use. These are basically the, you know, called the colossal AI offerings of performance and efficiency and cheapness. They did a lot of work on, you know, the memory distribution and, you know, the parallelism and the low latency inference. And, you know, they also claim they're quite popular on GitHub in terms of stars compared to other projects. Definitely there's a lot of demand. They have a platform you can go, they offer like train your data on demand, but I suggest you try it. Okay, now congratulations, you built your first really large language model, but can you tune, maintain, grow it without redoing everything from scratch? And that's where the Atrib tutorial comes here, or workshop, I don't remember. Is why do we care about attribution? You know, it's an avenue towards better language ML models, created assignment. Okay, we didn't talk about that, but you might have seen in the newspapers that there's this battle between publishers and New York Times and OpenAI and, I don't know, Cohere and everybody else. Nobody knows how much money they should pay to New York Times, for example, in order to use the content. New York Times doesn't know really what to charge. So I've organized in the past workshops about pricing data. It's not an easy problem. So the credit assignment is a big thing, because once we solve that, then it's going to accelerate the absorption of content, because a lot of people are hesitant to share the content because they don't know if they're giving something for free. They believe the days of, you know, Google, you know, taking all the data from the news providers for free and getting a lot of money by selling ads are over. People are much more cautious about giving access to their data. Of course, there are pure science reasons. And, you know, model interpretability, identifying failures, you know, toxicity, these are also things that people care about. Okay, so let's go one by one. Pillar one, I think the authors here did a very good job in order to, you know, presenting their argument. So the motivating questions, can we pinpoint behavior like concepts, capability, performance to specific training data points? The gold standard is, if we trained on data S instead of S prime, what would happen to model predictions, training dynamics, other outcomes for interest? Okay, how much does this article help me answer that question, you know, for New York Times? The key challenge is that retraining models is very expensive. You know, you can't really do that again and again and again in order to, you know, People do that in machine learning, you know, in supply values and other cases, they try different permutations of the data in order to understand what's going on. We can't really afford that here. You know, model attribution pillar two is, can we get a better understanding of how model parameters contribute to ML? You know, the gold standard here is that a simple, predictable way to make models have or not have any behavior in this interest by editing a parameters directly. This is super difficult, saying, okay, let me remove that attention layer or this head, or let's make everything zero or edit it in order to edit it. So that's, we have no idea how to do that. This is one of the most difficult tasks. And the pillar three is, can we give succinct explanations of how algorithmic choices, pre-training, early HF, data augmentation, impact resulting models? We did see before that paper that said, well, you know, add code to your training data and that's going to improve it. That's kind of like a heuristic. We did see that there are algorithmic improvements in order to remove RLHF. And so we made some progress here, but we're far away from being able to predict how, you know, new algorithm components are going to qualitatively affect data. Now, there is a paper over here called Data Inf, Efficiently Estimating Data Influence in LoRa-Tuned LLMs and Diffusion Models. There's probably more on that. But there might be another direction over here. There is this paper called Tiny Stories, nothing to do with, I don't think, you know, make sure, I don't think it was at NeurIPS. But I found it as I was trying to answer some other questions. And there was this idea, what can we do with, like, are tiny LLMs, like the small ones, useful, and what are the challenges? So basically this paper, which I really enjoyed reading, you know, raises the question of whether we can design a data set that preserves the essential elements of natural language, such as grammar, vocabulary, facts, and reasoning, but that it's much smaller and more refined in terms of its breadth and diversity. So usually small language models, you know, they even struggle battle with the grammar and, you know, coherence. And so they work on that and they realize that you can use like GPT-4 and with some prompting to generate a smaller data set that is very good for pre-training small models. And so the whole art goes in how you craft that data set. And they did so very competitive performance with much larger language models. So that took me back to the days where I was doing feature engineering with XCBoost. And, you know, the whole art, like you had this data scientist that they could take this small model and do the art of good feature engineering and sampling and some other tricks. And they could take, you know, a baseline, which is like 80%, and with right feature engineering, get it to the 90s and win the Kaggle competition. So the whole value wasn't really on XCBoost, it was on the data scientists who would do the feature engineering. And of course, we're probably past that right now. We have more automated ways of doing that. But, you know, the nice thing about this tiny LLMs is that you can have fast training cycles. So I can experiment with different data sets, take that in and out. The same thing that you could run, you know, feature engineering tasks, you know, on, you know, hundreds or thousands of times and pick the one that was giving you the best results. So maybe if we can, if we're able to work with smaller language models, we can run multiple iterations. You know, they fit in one small GPU, which is cheap, which means that now I can run, you know, within a few hours, many experiments. Maybe that's another way of addressing what Attrib is doing. And if what our friends are saying, that you can compose bigger language models or task-specific models with smaller ones, you know, maybe it's another direction to look at. Okay, so we're going to do a break here. We covered the second part, which had to do with, getting into the details of large language models and, you know, how to democratize them, build them, tune them, all that stuff. And in the next part, we're going to talk about mathematics, reasoning, and language models.